Claim a joyful sound and let it be heard. Proclaim to the ends of the earth, the Lord has freed his people. Hallelujah. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And welcome to you all here in church this morning, and of course to all those who are sharing in our service from the comfort of their homes. Today is the sixth Sunday in the season of Easter, and we pray that the Ascension on Thursday and our Pentecost coming in 2 weeks' time will be occasions for great celebration, as is today. But first we come into God's presence. We open our hearts before him. We lay before him our sadnesses and our joys, our fears and our hopes, as we pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters, as we prepare to celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us first call to mind and confess our sins. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lord,
have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy
have delivered us from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of your Son. Grant that as by his death he has recalled us to life, so by his continual presence in us he may raise us to eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. While Peter was speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" So he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they invited him to stay for several days. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Alleluia, alleluia. Jesus said, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we shall come to him. Alleluia. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Would you please? A sort of mini confession begins this homily this morning. I do have an account on Facebook, and I do look at it quite frequently. And recently on Facebook, this question was posed by someone. Is there anyone who has not seen an episode of Love Island? Now, I know, of course, that you have never seen an episode of Love Island, at least in my greatest hopes that might be the case. But for those of you who've never seen Love Island, I'd better explain what it is. Well, the concept, I suppose, in a nutshell is this. A group of young people are brought together in a luxury villa in some wonderful part of the world, and they find themselves under constant surveillance. And the idea is to get paired up with someone else. And this happens initially on first impression. As the series evolves, various things happen, votes take place, the public have a say, and anyone who remains single is sent home. At the end, one couple win and take home £50,000. This series of programmes is steeped in controversy. Believe it or not, four people linked to the show have committed suicide, and there have been many criticisms about the controlling and abusive male contestants. Indeed, the Mental Health Foundation believes that the show has a negative effect on viewers, many of whom have what you might describe as low body self-esteem, because all the contestants are tanned and look slim and beautiful and handsome. You might wonder why I've raised this on this particular Sunday. But it seems to me that there is a huge disparity between what the media calls love and what you and I as Christians understand by it. And it's a very far cry from what we understand that Jesus is saying about loving. I know you are paying great attention in the gospel reading, and you will already have noticed that in those 9 verses, Jesus uses the word love 9 times. So clearly, it's very important. It's also a golden thread that runs through his entire ministry. And if you know your Gospel of John, you'll know that this reading is part of a lengthy discourse that takes place just after the Last Supper. And so I suppose it would not be wrong to think of what Jesus is saying as a sort of extended farewell speech. He's trying to prepare the disciples for what was to happen to him, but more than that, trying to get them to look beyond his death and resurrection, and reminding them that they would be responsible for carrying on his ministry. And he does this by telling them that they need to love as he loved, generously and sacrificially. And if they do this, he tells them, his joy would be in them and their joy would be complete. So I suppose we could say that this is the blueprint for all of us who wish to follow Jesus. But what we see is not a love that is selfish or individual or self-serving, but has as its basis a relationship with him, but a relationship with him that is shared in community, the community that you and I call the church. He stresses that the disciples should remain together. He says, remain in that love. And of course, for those first disciples, and for you and I, none of this is easy. And Jesus, of course, was fully aware of that. That's why he exhorts the disciples to abide in love. Abide, to live in love, and to live love. And it seems to me that to abide in his love means constantly risking our love for others. It perhaps even means putting our faith on the line, living out the mantra, take up your cross. And if we abide in his love, then there is the possibility that we will suffer the same rejection, the same ridicule, and the same negativity that he experienced. Someone once said that Christianity is not a sprint, it's more like a marathon. And again, Jesus was fully aware of this. I'm reminded of that marvellous parable of the king's banquet. Remember it? All the invited guests gave back word and failed to attend. And even some of those dragged in from the highways and the byways didn't go to the banquet with very good grace. The church often stresses that we need to have a personal relationship with Jesus. And yes, that's true. But it's very easy to fall into the secular trap of the cult of the individual, just as we see from TV shows like Love Island, where it's self-centered, where it's focused on me and not on others. Last week in our gospel reading, we looked at the concept of the vine and the branches. And I think, and I hope, that we recognize the interconnectivity of each of us with everyone else, but that we derive our strength and our very being from the vine itself. St. Paul elsewhere in the New Testament uses the analogy of the body with its many limbs and organs, which together form the entire body. And each has its own function, but needs to be connected with the whole. And I've seen many examples of how this works out in reality in this last year of pandemic. All of us, I'm sure you would agree, have given up a great deal over the year. We've had to sacrifice what is important to us, meeting friends and family, hugging, and even smiling at each other. But I hope and I pray that through it we've all become stronger. And I hope and pray that we've all realized what is truly important in life. People are asking the question, will we ever go back to where we were? Perhaps. Perhaps not. Perhaps where we were was not the place that we need to be. And it poses a question for the church. Have we, as a church with a capital C, and the church here in Lund, become more allied closely to our community, the sort of church that I believe Christ envisioned? And I think here in Lund, we've had a good stab at it. We've reached out far beyond where we might otherwise have done with our live stream services. And we've reached more people than perhaps we could ever have expected. But we're here at a moment in time, and we need not so much to look back, but to look forward. How can we carry this work forward? What can we do to develop links within and even beyond our local community? And then the $64,000 question, are we actually ready to move forward as we hope and pray we can do so with a new parish priest? What is absolutely true is that society has been of necessity fragmented by the lockdown and the restrictions. But despite all this, many individuals and many organisations have stepped up to the plate to support and care for individuals most affected by being isolated and who are unable to physically share their lives with friends and families. You will remember and know many examples of this in our local community, the unsung heroes of this pandemic. St. Augustine once posed this question. He said, "What does love look like? It has the hands to help others. It has the feet to hasten to the poor and needy. It has the eyes to see misery and want. It has the ears to hear the sighs and sorrows of people. That is what love looks like." And so that's the overriding message of today's gospel, that we are appointed to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, fruit that isn't transitory as the world is outside, where good looks fade and relationships based on celebrity or attraction collapse. No. Our relationship with Jesus, and through that our relationship with each other, is based on far stronger grounds. Because at the bottom of all this, we remember that Jesus' love for us is a love that never falters, never rejects, never hurts, and never demands. Other than that one fundamental command, to love one another as he first loved us. Amen. Let us pray. All we are and all we have we offer, Lord, to you. We offer you our hands that you might use them in and through our daily lives. We offer you our feet that you might lead them to someone who needs our help. We offer you our shoulders if you should use them to help lighten another's load. We offer you our voices that you might use them to speak up for those in need. All we are and all we have, we offer, Lord, to you. Amen. And so let us stand now and confess our faith in the words of the Lord. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Let us pray for the Church and for the world, and let us thank God for his goodness.
Faithful God, your Son Jesus Christ gave us a new commandment of love for each other, and so we ask you to teach us to love you in our neighbours, and that by serving them we might also serve you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, we pray for your church, which day by day gathers to praise you and to hear your holy word. We pray for our Christian sisters and brothers, worshipping around the world in small rural churches, like this one, great city cathedrals, and on the internet. Give us here in our parish a sense of expectation as we come and inspiration as we go. We continue to pray for our bishops, Julian, Philip and Jill, and for those who enable worship in this church. We pray too for those charged with the appointment of a new priest to lead this parish forward, and for those who may offer themselves for consideration. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creator God, the world so often seems to be a violent and fearful place. Give us the strength to love our enemies and to pray for those who by violence and acts of terrorism distort and demonize your wonderful creation. We pray for all those who have been successful in Thursday's elections, that they may ever be mindful of their responsibility to serve their constituents with care and equanimity. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father God, may our closeness to family and friends make us never exclusive, shutting others out, but always inclusive, welcoming others. Encourage us in outgoing hospitality and keep us from becoming possessive with those we love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, help us all to be a part of the healing ministry of your church. Encourage us to constantly pray for those we know who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit, and from the coronavirus. Deepen our love for our neighbours, especially those who are weak. Help us to console the sorrowful and give hope to the dying. From those for whom our prayers have been asked, we hold before you especially Margaret Nicol, Rosemary Cartwright. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful God, your love reaches beyond the grave. At the end of our days on earth, be with us and with those we love, and with those whom we love and have gone before us. We pray now for those who have recently died, and those whose years, mind, or anniversaries occur this week. Give to the departed the perfect joy of your eternal love, and to those bereaved by their passing, the consolation of your perfect love. We remember especially Margaret Maine, Jesse Winlow. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. May they rest in peace. Amen. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our
prayer. Holy God, send us out into the world today, mindful that as witnesses and servants, we should make you known in every place we visit and bear witness to the gospel with acts of faith and hope and love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
The risen Christ came and stood amongst his disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." Then were they glad when they saw the risen Lord. And so the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
May our prayers rise up to you, O Lord, so that purified by your graciousness, we may be conformed to the mysteries of your mighty love. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our service will continue this morning with Eucharistic Prayer E. Prayer E. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. From sunrise to sunset, this day is holy. For Christ is risen from the tomb and scatters the darkness of death with light that will not fade. This day the risen Lord walks with your gathered people, unfolds for us your word, and makes himself known in the breaking of bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live in endless light, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so with choirs of angels, and with all the heavenly hosts, we proclaim your glory and join their unending song of praise. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised him, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood in the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Christ is the bread of life. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, Lord Jesus, until you come in glory. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes, and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with Mary, the Virgin Mother of our Lord, St. John the Baptist, the Evangelist, and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour Jesus Christ has taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
If you love me, keep my commandments, says the Lord. And I will ask the Father, and he will send you another Paraclete to abide with you forever. Alleluia.
Thank you.
watch. Father, whose Son Jesus Christ gives the water of eternal life, may we thirst for you, the spring of life and source of goodness, through him who is alive and reigns now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Just a couple of notices that need to be made this morning. Amazingly, whilst Nigel is playing at the Drive Methodist Church in St. Anne's this morning, he is also by the virtue of technology with us here this morning. So we thank you, Nigel, for spending I don't know how many hours putting our CD together on the organ he has at home, so that we can still have our CD today. So I think he deserves a round of applause in that Secondly, just a reminder that today marks the beginning of Christian Aid Week. This is going to be, like it was last year, somewhat difficult to Christian Aid because of the restrictions that there are. But there is one of those wonderful artistic QR codes on the back of your pew. There's, if you're technologically minded and you wish to make a donation to Christian Family, if you take that, zap that with your phone, something exotic happens. I'm not sure quite what happens. I'm sure that it's not some sort of scam where something that your current account is sort of depleted and everything's in there. There will be instructions to follow because you're going to be wanting QR. So there you go. I'm able to go myself today just to see if it does really work. A couple of lovely things to do this morning that we haven't done for quite some time, so I hope I can remember what I'm supposed to do. We're very pleased to have George and Jenny with us this morning. They're going to commit matrimony very shortly. And the first step to that, of course, is for me to read the vows and encourage anyone who has an objection to make it very lively. I'm sure that will sound like the folks can see it. They're quite a nice congregation here, generally speaking, even though they've been masked all year. So it is with great pleasure that I publish the vows of marriage between George James Gunn, C.
single of this parish, and Jenny Louise Ball, single also of this parish. If any of you know a reason why these two people should not be joined together in holy matrimony, then you are to declare it. And this is the first time of asking. And we have also a very special person in our congregation this morning, who I understand celebrated a birthday yesterday. Now, what's his name? I can't remember his name now. Let me just think. Begins with a W. Could it be William? Excellent. And did you get lots of presents, William? What about cake? Cake? Not a birthday without cake, is it? So I think we ought to wish William a very happy birthday in the accepted manner. I'm afraid we have no audience companies this morning without shooting so much. So, William?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear William. Happy birthday to you.
Very good, thank you.
Which is well pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father,
upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.